In the future, humans have created robots to handle daily tasks instead of them. These robots, known as surrogates, are controlled by signals from special chairs. This arrangement allows people to remain safe at home while their surrogates carry out their activities. Consequently, there has been a significant decrease in crime rates, and societal harmony has improved with reduced instances of racism and hate. Nearly everyone has embraced the use of surrogates, considering it the new normal. However, a growing dissenting faction known as the Dreads has emerged, condemning surrogates as deceitful. These Dreads have established isolated zones within cities worldwide, and they are led by a figure named Zaire Powell. One night, a rich young man gets driven around by his chauffeur. He decides going to the theater would be boring and chooses to go to a club instead, following the driver's suggestion. While at the club, he dances with strangers and becomes interested in a woman. They sneak off to an alley to kiss, but suddenly, a strange person shows up. The man rudely tells this person to leave, calling them a meatbag. Suddenly, they're hit with electricity, and the figure runs away. FBI agents Peters and Greer come to the scene and find the man and woman, who turn out to be surrogates. A police officer explains that the male surrogate isn't registered, and the female one belongs to someone who hasn't reported anything. They notice that both surrogates have had their eyes damaged, and Greer sees that the male surrogate's memory chip is broken. Later, Greer and Peters go to the apartment of the person controlling the female surrogate and discover him dead with a bloody nose. Greer checks the last thing the female surrogate saw and witnesses the male surrogate's eyes burning and shattering before the feed ends abruptly. Returning home, Greer, who is revealed to be a surrogate himself, takes a moment to drink water before parking himself in a closet. He then leaves his stim chair and looks at his own surrogate before entering a child's room. Inside, he sees a photo of himself, his wife, and a child before closing the door. Greer finds his wife's surrogate and suggests they take a vacation. Maggie, his wife, proposes taking their surrogates to Hawaii, but Greer desires a physical getaway without the surrogates. He mentions they haven't spent real time together for a while, which upsets Maggie. She argues that they're together every day through their surrogates, but Greer insists it's not the same and suggests it might be better to be physically present with each other. In a college dormitory in San Diego, teenagers discover their friend Jared sitting lifeless on his stim chair covered in blood. Police Chief Andrew briefs the station about the grim discovery, revealing that both Jared and the operator of the female surrogate had their brains liquefied. It appears that whatever happened to their surrogates caused their deaths. Greer and Peters review footage from the surrogates and spot a man carrying a weapon, leading Greer to suspect foul play. They receive a phone call revealing that Jared is the son of surrogate pioneer Lionel Cantor. A news report sheds light on Lionel's significant role in surrogacy, dubbing him the father of the technology. Despite founding Virtual Self Industries, VSI, one of the largest corporations globally, Lionel was ousted by his partners years ago. This humiliating event led him to become a recluse, avoiding public attention for nearly a decade. Greer and Peters pay a visit to Lionel's residence, where they are greeted by one of his surrogates. Lionel informs the detectives that he and Jared had been estranged for a long time. When Jared started college, Lionel offered him the use of any of his surrogates as a way to reconnect with his son. Peters emphasizes the importance of not allowing surrogates registered to one individual to be used by others. Greer reassures Lionel that they mean no disrespect and are solely focused on solving Jared's death. Peters' questioning agitates Lionel, but Greer intervenes, expressing his understanding as someone who has also experienced the loss of a child. Lionel pauses, visibly affected, and eventually calms down. Greer asks if Lionel knows of anyone who might have wanted to harm either himself or Jared. It dawns on Lionel that the target of the attack was actually him, not Jared. The assassin didn't realize that the person using Lionel's surrogate was Jared. Realizing his mistake, Lionel logs out of the surrogate. Lionel sits in his stim chair, tears streaming down his face, overcome with the heavy realization that his actions inadvertently led to his son's death. Greer and Peters proceed to VSI and meet with representatives, querying if they are aware of any instances where a surrogate's head exploded, resulting in the death of its operator. The representatives defensively assure Greer that their safety protocols prevent such accidents. They then venture to the engineering floor, where they consult with an engineer. Greer presents the fried identity chip from Jared's surrogate, prompting the engineer to suggest that such an event could only occur if all circuits fired simultaneously. Moreover, the engineer reveals that a shipment of surrogates from the military arrived with missing optics and identity chips. Following this lead, Greer and Peters visit a military camp to observe surrogate soldiers in action on the battlefield. They witness a surrogate being destroyed by enemy fire, only for its operator to seamlessly transition into another surrogate. The military colonel reassures them that any weapon used against a surrogate would not harm its operator. Additionally, he discloses that the military routinely removes motherboards and optics from surrogates for analysis purposes. Back at the station, Peters identifies the man wielding the weapon in the video footage as Miles, a non-surrogate user. They rush to the monitoring department, where technician Bobby informs them that Miles has been located. Greer heads off to coordinate with the pursuit team, while Peters stays with Bobby to monitor Miles's movements. As they keep tabs on Miles, Bobby casually mentions that tracking him was straightforward because they have access to all surrogate feeds in the city. An alarm suddenly blares and Bobby observes a man attacking a woman through the surrogate feed. He swiftly reports the incident and requests an immediate shutdown of the assailant's surrogate. Bobby promptly receives authorization and shuts down the surrogates involved. Peters is taken aback, unaware that surrogates could be remotely deactivated, and questions the legality of the procedure. Bobby dismisses her concerns, insisting that the police are the good guys. However, Peters worries about the potential misuse of such technology, fearing it could fall into the wrong hands. Miles races through the streets on his motorcycle, closely pursued by police cars. He maneuvers skillfully through traffic, narrowly avoiding collisions with oncoming vehicles. Greer observes the chase from a helicopter overhead. Suddenly, Miles crashes into an alley and finds himself surrounded by police officers. Drawing a weapon, he unleashes a powerful wave of electricity that incapacitates the officers' surrogates, causing them to convulse and their eyes to pop out. He then aims the weapon at the helicopter. Reacting swiftly, Greer disconnects from his surrogate just in time, but the pilot isn't as fortunate. The helicopter spirals out of control, heading towards a settlement of the Dreads. As Miles flees into the Dread settlement, Greer reconnects to his surrogate, only to crash into the isolation zone. Emerging from the wreckage, Greer gives chase to Miles, unaware that his presence has angered the inhabitants of the Dread settlement, who now pursue him in retaliation. Greer and Miles navigate through the slums, darting between trailers as they move. Miles attempts to activate the weapon, but it's currently disabled. Greer effortlessly vaults over trailers and scales them until he corners Miles. Demanding the weapon, Greer receives a bag from Miles, but before he can inspect its contents, a shotgun blast sends him flying. Miles retrieves the weapon as Greer is shot by a woman who denounces him as an abomination. Greer disconnects from his surrogate, collapsing from his stim chair and calling out for Maggie. Hearing his cries, Maggie rushes to his aid and contacts an ambulance. Later, Miles regains consciousness to find Prophet Powell and his followers ransacking his home in search of the weapon. Powell interrogates Miles about its origin, and Miles confesses that he never learned the identity of the person behind it. Their communication was limited to disposable cell phones, and Miles was only paid to utilize the weapon. A news report later announces that Prophet Powell perceives the crashed helicopter as an assault on the Dreads' territory and declares a revolution against surrogate users. Meanwhile, Greer regains consciousness at the hospital, where Adam informs him of his suspension from duty. Adam reassures Greer that he'll handle the case personally and advises him to rest. Frustrated by the Bureau's decision, Greer decides to leave the hospital against medical advice. Concerned that the Bureau might not prioritize investigating Miles's weapon, he sets out with Peters to return to the station. As they walk, Greer begins to feel dizzy and disoriented, a side effect of prolonged surrogate use. Peters explains the phenomenon to him. Determined to pursue the case, Greer decides to visit the Dread colony, believing that without using a surrogate, he'll have an easier time gaining entry. Inside the colony, he is shocked to find his own surrogate crucified and learns that Miles has died. At Miles's funeral, Prophet Powell delivers a speech, portraying Miles's death as a testament to true humanity, contrasting it with the artificiality of surrogates. After Miles's funeral, Greer approaches Powell, but Powell's henchmen attack him when he refuses to leave. Powell recognizes Greer as a surrogate user and mocks him, asserting that experiencing pain is as close to humanity as Greer will ever get. Greer presses Powell about the weapon, but Powell derisively brushes off his inquiry. Defeated, Greer departs, and Powell retrieves the weapon from his trailer's hidden compartment. As Greer waits, a car pulls up beside him, and he gets in. Inside, a young boy reveals himself as another of Lionel's surrogates. Lionel explains that he's unable to use his usual surrogates due to the attempt on his life. Frustrated with the lack of progress in Jared's case, Lionel vents to Greer. Greer shares that Jared's assassin is dead, killed by Powell. He then confides in Lionel about his own loss, recounting how he tragically lost his son in a car accident. He emphasizes to Lionel the profound anguish of a parent outliving their child. Following Lionel's advice, Greer decides to focus his investigation on the weapon. Lionel suggests that if they can trace the weapon's origin, they might uncover who wanted him dead. He explains that the Dreads likely couldn't have produced such a weapon due to the extensive research and funds required. Returning home, Greer gets into a heated argument with Maggie. He expresses his desire to be with his real wife, not a surrogate. Maggie, feeling hurt, insists that she is still there for him, but Greer feels that things have changed between them. Defeated, Maggie retreats to her room, where she removes her goggles and breaks down in tears. Meanwhile, Greer returns to the station and discovers information indicating that VSI had entered into a weapon contract with the military. However, the contract was abruptly terminated, and the reason for its termination is classified. Later that night, a surrogate infiltrates Peters' home, accessing recordings of her experiences and discovering Bobby's involvement in the police's surveillance capabilities. The surrogate then fatally shoots Peters in her sleep before taking control of her surrogate and implanting it with a remote operator. At the station, Peters' surrogate suddenly activates. The following day, Greer meets with the military colonel and presents a picture of the weapon. The colonel admits to being aware of its existence, revealing that it's an overload device developed by VSI for military use. Initially, the device caused fatalities during testing, and all prototypes were thought to have been destroyed afterward. Greer informs the colonel that the Dreads now possess the weapon. In response, the colonel hastily departs, vowing that the military will take charge of retrieving the weapon. Meanwhile, at the Dread Zone, Powell hands the weapon to his henchmen, instructing them to deliver it to Peters at the police station. Meanwhile, Greer visits Maggie's salon to discuss the events of the previous night. Maggie seems surprised and reluctant to engage in the conversation. Despite this, Greer brings up their deceased son, hoping to connect with her. However, Maggie becomes frustrated, revealing that her surrogate has been her lifeline, providing an escape from her reality. Despite Greer's efforts to appeal to her, Maggie logs out of her surrogate. Back at home, Maggie reaches for a bottle of medication, indicating her struggle with her emotional state. Meanwhile, the military launches an invasion of the Dread Zone to retrieve the weapon. Soldiers descend from helicopters as the Dread inhabitants scramble to hide. Powell and his followers attempt to flee, but are confronted by the military. A fierce firefight erupts, but Powell's forces are quickly overwhelmed. Powell himself is shot, and as the military closes in, they make a startling discovery. Powell, the leader of the anti-surrogacy movement, is revealed to be a surrogate, with Lionel finally unveiled as his operator. Greer meets with who he believes is Peter's surrogate, and it reveals that Miles had been working with Andrew. It turns out Andrew had hired Miles to assassinate Lionel. Determined, Greer heads to the station to confront Andrew about what he has uncovered. Greer questions Andrew about his motivations for wanting Lionel dead. He pieces together a theory. VSI provided Andrew with the weapon, and Andrew hired Miles to carry out the assassination, resulting in Jared's accidental death. As Andrew avoids eye contact, Greer takes decisive action, stabbing the surrogate at the back of the head, shorting it out. He swiftly hacks into Andrew's computer, downloading any relevant files related to VSI and Miles. Meeting with Peter's surrogate, they leave the station. Examining the downloaded files, Greer discovers that Lionel is funding the anti-surrogacy movement, unaware of the possibility that Lionel could be its founder. Within the files, Greer also finds the codes needed to activate the weapon. However, Peters' surrogate contacts the station, revealing Greer's location and actions. Suddenly, a truck crashes into their car, throwing them off course. Peters manages to grab the weapon and walks away, but Greer decides to chase after her, attempting to run her over. They speed through crowded streets, hitting other cars and surrogates along the way. Greer eventually crashes into a store window, allowing Peters to escape. Hiding from the FBI agents chasing him, Greer steals another car. He calls Bobby and asks him to deactivate Peter's surrogate, but Peters has already done it herself. Bobby warns Greer that Peters is trying to take control of all the surrogates. Meanwhile, Andrew confronts Peters on the monitoring level. He tries to reason with her, but it's revealed that Lionel is actually the one controlling Peter's surrogate. Andrew argues with Lionel, saying that surrogates are a gift to the world, and destroying them would be a step backward for humanity. VSI had no other choice but to eliminate Lionel because destroying the surrogates would harm society. Lionel expresses his desire for people to live as genuine human beings. He then aims the weapon at Andrew, causing his surrogate's computer to short out and destroy it, finally avenging Jared's death. Meanwhile, Greer arrives at Lionel's residence, demanding to speak with the real Lionel. Determined, he forces his way inside, searching for Lionel. At the same time, Peter's surrogate initiates a virus upload into all the surrogates, intending to eliminate everyone using surrogates. As Greer explores Lionel's home, he discovers a hidden door leading to Lionel's chamber. Inside, he finds numerous surrogates, including Powell and the man responsible for Peter's death. Greer discovers Lionel seated in a wheelchair, aiming a gun at him. Lionel questions whether Greer can sense his accelerated pulse and sweating, probing whether Greer misses the sensation of being truly human. He asserts that in a world where people live through surrogates, true humanity is lost. Lionel believes that those living within surrogates are already dead, viewing his plan to eliminate them as a service to humanity. He deems surrogacy as a perversion and sick addiction. As a warning signal announces the completion of the virus upload, Lionel completes his final act of will by ingesting a cyanide pill, taking his own life. Greer intervenes, removing Lionel from the stim chair and logging into Peter's surrogate. With time ticking down, Greer urgently consults Bobby for guidance on halting the virus transmission. With seconds to spare, Greer successfully prevents the spread of the virus, ensuring the safety of the operators. However, the virus remains active, threatening to destroy the surrogates. Bobby guides Greer through the process of preventing the surrogates from being destroyed, while a team of operatives storms the facility. However, as Greer is on the verge of confirming the virus termination, he hesitates. Ultimately, he decides to allow the virus to be transmitted to the surrogates. Just as Greer presses the button, an operative shoots Peter's surrogate. Suddenly, all the surrogates across the city become lifeless as the virus takes effect. Streets and buildings are littered with deactivated surrogates. Greer steps outside and witnesses the aftermath, seeing people emerging from their homes, bewildered and disoriented, some venturing outside for the first time in a long while. Returning home, Greer finally reunites with his wife Maggie, who stands by the window. They share a tender moment, embracing each other. Later news reports confirm that surrogates worldwide have been deactivated, with no human casualties reported. Humanity now faces the uncertain task of reintegrating into the real world. And with this, the movie comes to an end. Thanks for tuning in, guys.